Okay, just before I begin, I make no claims towards internet revolution, and nor do I claim that of its lack of revolution or lack of causing trigger. I sit somewhere as an artist who's used the internet extensively in the work, in my practice, and how the internet has enabled the practice itself and enabled discussion. So I'm just going to take you through three images right now. Would you like to guess what this is? Anyone? Sorry?
I could. These are all weapons that women carry in their bags to alert others in the event that they may be assaulted or potentially assaulted.
Right. So back in 2007, we asked women on Facebook and on our blog to send in a list of things they don't leave home without. And we got a range of responses. Not that we prescribe any of these as formulas for, we're not for defense and weapons of defense, definitely not. But we just wanted to create a kind of, we wanted to create a space to be able to talk about fear and the fact that women experience fear in their cities every single day. Back in 2003, I was a student at Srishti School of Art and Design, and I was graduating. I remember Sundar came in for one of our, the day I proposed this project, actually. There was this kind of environment where people didn't really want to give it a vocabulary. The fact that, let me just go to this mind map. Then I'll get back to the attitudes around it. I got all the girls in college, because in my head at that time it was this all-girl issue. And I got them all, and I just asked them to make a mind map with the word public space, and you have the results right in front of you. Can I just take this out? And that itself gave the basis to propose a project, propose a conversation that would explore all of these negative emotions in relation to the public space. You can see for yourself there's defense, there's claustrophobic, discomfort, vulnerability, aggression, stare, not wanting to be seen. Out of the 60, about 9 were willing to take this forward. The rest said this is something you can't do anything about. It happens. It's just teasing. You can't change men. You know, things are like this. So there was a kind of denial, and there was an acceptance of. Given that with these 9, we started a series of workshops that went on for about 3 months that explored the public and private identities of these 9 participants, whom we now celebrate as action heroes. And for the first time, we got to experience the issue of, got to understand the issue of street harassment from 9 other people's lived experiences. And it was a very intimate process of sharing and getting to really understand the issue. Then after graduation and after this exhibition inside Srishti campus, there was this big challenge of where is the public, how do we take this to the next level, where do we begin? And I found myself documenting all of this work online. I started blogging just out of complete curiosity. And I found myself doing things that I would, well, what I'm going to share now actually is something that would be extremely controversial in the notion of social justice itself, because that's, and I think that some people here have also participated and responded to this, where I found myself taking photographs of people I felt intimidated by, or who harassed me or groped me, and this is through 2004, and I would share this on the blog. And then also put down section 354 of the Indian Penal Code, and without realizing, what ended up happening in this process is that a kind of public debate started, generating about is this harassment or not? Is this, what is the difference between flirting and wooing and harassment? What is consent? What about different cultural backgrounds or how somebody interprets harassment could be somebody else's idea of flirting? What about the kind of fear that and biases that we carry also in terms of whose idea of social justice is this, and whose, so it threw open a lot of conversations and questions on ethics and which we learned from. And today, I mean, the photographs don't sit like this on the blog. You can't tell who the person is. But the result of this was that people started talking about and there was a sort of collective defining of the issue on the blog space only at that time. So, for example, this is of a person who sat diagonally opposite me at India Coffee House and poking and nudging his friend and smiling at me, and I made it very clear that his behavior was not welcome. However, that didn't stop. Then I finally handed him a pamphlet which defined his behavior as street sexual harassment, and then I walked out of the shop. That had the number. Yeah? Oh, okay. So,
there is a loose connection at the bottom.
Loose connection is your
bottom.
It is a loose connection. So this person was in panic and he kept calling back because there was a number listed on the pamphlet which was a blank noise number, and I was taking those calls at that time, and he just kept saying it wasn't sexual harassment because in his mind it was only a crush. And that just threw open this debate on, you know, conversations on are there flirt spaces in the city, or how do people ask each other out? Hello? Yeah. Can I take? Thank you. I see blank noise today as it's not a singular voice. It's multitudes of voices. It's arguments, counter arguments, testimonials, conflict, disagreements that have shaped the nature of the collective. It sits in that plurality. And yes, it is the web, it is the internet, but we work with different forms of media as in we didn't set out to seek the internet and explore the internet, but rather we were interested in engagement, we were interested in communities, and therefore we could work across forms of media that reach to various communities or build testimonials with various communities. So just to say that this woman does not take photos of threatening male strangers anymore. This is also an attempt to seek strategic ways of confronting the situation while encountering the vast range of male behavior in the street. We never ever proposed this as a solution, but I'm sharing that those case studies only to be able to talk about what happened as a process of photographing, sharing, publishing those on the going back and forth, and what kind of debate it triggered. Back in 2006, one of our volunteers, Smita Jain, volunteers, aka Action Hero Smita Jain, she said, why don't we do something called the Blogathon? She defined the Blogathon as this event that would be announced by bloggers to build testimonials of street sexual harassment. And on the 8th of March in 2006, a group of us got together and wrote to various bloggers who announced this event. And before we knew it, we had hundreds of testimonials coming in. And suddenly the blog space was being seen as this safe space for some people to be able to share their experiences, a lot of people were speaking for the first time, remembering things that happened to them 20 years ago and had never given words to that experience. So as a result of that blogathon, there was a sudden attention to the issue of what was being called eve teasing but was street sexual violence, the fact that it had impacted women's relationship with their cities, with their bodies. And before we knew it, these blog posts were just traveling mailing lists, and suddenly the international press picked it up, then the local press picked it up, and before we knew it, we had people writing into us from different cities saying they wanted to start chapters. And that's really how, with that kind of fluidity, spontaneity, and momentum, the project sort of started taking shape. So the internet has influenced the way blank noise is even structured, where it's not it's really been very fluid, very spontaneous, and I treat it more and more as a living organism where it's a volunteer or an action hero is taking it with his or her question. Whoever's coming in is engaging and building it in the direction he or she takes it to or investigates. And my role in all of this is to facilitate these conversations and to facilitate events. And so, for example, with the blogathon, one of the things we realized is that a lot of women seem to remember what they were wearing when they experienced sexual violence. So to be able to draw patterns from these testimonials and realize that that's led to a campaign called I Never Ask For It. So to be able to reject blame. So it's we as Blank Noise members, we gather testimonials, we put them back outside for people. We create a safe space for testimonials to reach us and find appropriate media for the testimonials to go forward. Just to quickly introduce what Blank Noise is again. So it has male and female members. It's built on the lived experiences. And like I said, it's a multitude of thoughts, opinions, and contradictions too. And action heroes are individuals who are just setting new rules for street behavior. They're not surrendering to power. And in terms of the things we've done, we've also sort of taken things online and onto the streets and back online, and it's a fluid transfer or fluid sort of travel between different spaces, because our core intention is engagement and connecting with people and communities. So this is back in 2005, where we created these opinion polls that are bilingual, and we just invited, because if we went around saying, have you experienced street sexual violence and come talk to us about it, we would get a flat no. But if we asked, if we created strategies that were like this opinion poll that was in your face at the same time, very clinical and appearing to people, these were hosted on the streets. This is Namita Sharma, who runs a tea stall in Garhiahat Market in Calcutta. She just hosted it at her stall for a week, which is next to the auto stand. Or we did this event around Garhiahat Market in Calcutta, where people in solidarity, street vendors in solidarity, wore these red arrows, and people, also action heroes from the whole lot of the event online, came forward and stopped at every opinion poll and put their thumbprint and generated dialogue on this. And that was a week-long, we treated it as a week-long project where even, the entire community around Garhiahat got involved. Then we've done things like the night action plan. So in terms of how the web or the blog has enabled our actions, is, for example, with the night action plan, you announce this event. This is again back in 2006, and then we did it again in 2009, where we went around as a gang of girls to fictionalize, and in quotes, also not fictionalize, because street sexual violence could happen anywhere. And we went around late at night in Delhi and in Bangalore and spraying testimonials in a very report-like manner. So it's Mohini, who's 19, this happened to her at 8 in the morning, a stranger rubbed himself against me. Or there's Radha, who's 60, and she's walking around at 6 in the morning and a van is following me and saying, will you come? Or there's Pinky, who's 9, or there's somebody else who's 25. And to create these fictional characters, but to also say that it's not happening to, in the fictionalized space of, it's happening to those women in those clothes at that time of the day. It's happening in your presence. It's happening right here. And you wanted the city to literally wake up to that. So we did this in marketplaces and residential neighborhoods, from Lajpat Nagar to South Extension. I'm just going to quickly go over this, just to say that we collect testimonials of various kinds, whether it's food names that women have been called on the street, or songs they've been sung to, or other adjectives and statements they've been called, and you turn that around. In terms of some of the street actions that we've done, it's also us announcing the event again on the blog, or now on Facebook or Twitter, and sometimes the local press picking it up and further announcing it. And also this word of mouth transfer, where if you're doing it repeatedly over a sustained period of time, there is a buzz, and friends bring friends and more friends, and sort of the network grows. But this is a street action where we just invite action heroes to come and be idle on the street. And what does it take for you to do that as a woman when you've been taught to just get home as fast as you can. And actually here, this is Action Hero Atri in Delhi Sarojinagar Market. She's holding letters as well. So a lot of the testimonials that came in from the blog, from the blogathon, were translated into letters addressed to strangers in the local language that could address to strangers saying, XYZ bloggers blog post of street harassment, and saying, it ends by saying, if you know what I'm talking about, come join me. I'm the girl by the railing, or I'm the girl standing here. So it also increases intimate process of participation. Please let me know if I'm short on time now. But sometimes we coordinate actions across different cities simultaneously. So while something's happening in Bangalore, something's happening in Bombay, another action's happening in Delhi. And again, back in 2008, we asked people to send in, women especially, to send in their wish list for the city. We got lots of responses, and we were struck by how simple they were in terms of, I wish I could just sit in the park. I wish I could just walk in the rain and not worry about my dress getting wet. I wish I could wear earrings that said sexy written on it. So just very simple things that were high priority wish lists for a lot of people in terms of wanting to unlearn fear. So the next year, we said, let's try that in Cubbon Park in Bangalore. Let's see. So here's Saraswati, Action Hero Saraswati, who says, I dared myself by yawning, by stretching, by pouting. But she used the vocabulary of having dared herself to do so. And for the first time, I was also participating rather than facilitating. And for me, this was a moment that really changed things, because suddenly we moved from, I think, the understanding of moving from defense to trust came in. The fact that I was trying to sleep really convincing myself to, you know, be able to sleep. But every time I would just wake up and realize it's just a leaf or it's just a dog that's passed by. And to think that there are more people on the street walking in fear of each other than with the actual intention to harm each other, that changed the tone of how we've been approaching our work and dialogues on, again, the web or any other kind of media. Talking of games, we've been playing the Action Hero game, where we've done this in a couple of cities and sometimes simultaneously in different cities, where people sign up they choose a place in the city that they've never been to before, and via Twitter they get instructions on their mobile phone to, you know, perform certain actions, and it goes on for 4 hours. And actions could include be idle, actions could include talk to a stranger and say something you've never said to anyone before, or volunteer somewhere for 30 minutes. And it's about what are the decisions that each person makes, and what do they, one is to be able to be willing to do this, and then to be able to, in a group discussion space, to be able to reflect on what are the decisions I did make, and how did I challenge my own fears, how did my biases shift in this process, and am I an action hero or not? So they go through their own version, their own idea, what does it mean to be an action hero for each of them. So over time, action heroes did report change, and they said that, you know, now I'm walking slowly in the middle of the pavement and I'm getting my space, or I'm not worried about what I'm wearing as much as I used to be. So based on these kind of responses, we published the step-by-step guide to unapologetic walking, which sits as posters but also in the form of t-shirts. I'm going to go quickly over this. When I mentioned that there has been the patterns and testimonials that talk about blame, one of the statements actually culled from the blogathon is, when I was 12, somebody leaned over and said, don't attract attention to yourself. This is a blogger called Neha Shri. So we've been, actually this year, we're relaunching this campaign called I Never Ask For It, and which is really about questioning blame, rejecting blame, arresting blame, and saying there's no excuse for sexual violence. And again, it's not only about street sexual violence, but how does somebody who's working in the area of domestic violence take this forward? How does somebody who's working in trafficking take this forward? How does somebody who's working in the area of child sexual abuse take this forward? Because it's this common thread of blame is quite universal, and it's really one language that's perpetuating sexual violence everywhere. And what we want to do is we want to create large-scale installations of these garments. That's one aspect of the project, but there's also a research side where an intern is researching attacks on women in the name of religion, culture, and tradition. And for, so I guess it's going to be, again, different forms of media and different communities participating to read and to be able to treat it in a complete sort of sense of really everybody in terms of different communities. Just quickly, this was something we did on Twitter and on Facebook some years ago, where we created these profile pictures and each said, "This, you know, she never asked for it," or "I never asked for it." And people could tweet what they wore. And again, what happened through the Twitter experience was that people across the world, seeming at least on the web, on Twitter, across the world, connected across the world through Twitter, were able to participate. And therefore, whether it was somebody sitting in Yemen or somebody sitting in New York or somebody sitting in India, everybody could remember. Why is it that most women seem to remember what they wore? I'm just going to go quickly over this too, which is, this is not web related at all, but we created the Ha 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 Sangha, which was a laughter club, and we've never done anything exclusively for women, and I would always cringe about that thought itself, but at the same time I wanted to see what would happen if we did this, what would happen. So here are some students who are Yalahanka Action Heroes, and they're also students from Srishti School of Art and Design, and we were working together for a month in 2012. And we would meet at this park every day. And here's Sampige, who's the caretaker of the park. And we just created this laughter club, but in a way of inviting women from across the neighborhood to come in and participate and join the laughter club. And again, you have people speaking different languages, but everybody's connected through laughter, and a safe space was created, and suddenly anonymity was broken, familiarity was established. It was intergenerational across languages and socioeconomic backgrounds, and a sense of safety and belonging was created within the neighborhood. And there's Yashoda, who, Action Hero Yashoda, who became the president of the Ha 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 Sangha. And then there's then we had Ha 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 Sangha Mantri. So this is as a format we'd like to explore this further. And one of the other things that the students would, within Yalahanka itself, we did a range of things, including mapping, and to derive from those maps. We interviewed a range of people, a wide demographic, from factory workers to domestic help to other college students to Srishti students itself. I'm done in 2 minutes, I think, hopefully. Despite that map, one of the things we kept hearing recurringly was there's something called the rapist lane, and the rapist lane is, you know, being we went to the site. We don't have any evidence of rape, but it had earned this nickname because of its high frequency of threat and the fact that it wasn't lit at night, and there were these empty buses and the infinite possibilities of what can happen in that situation. So we worked on this, and we said, first thing first, let's start calling it the safest lane, and let's pledge to make it the safest lane. So we did things like paint these gigantic action hero murals in 3 different parts of the lane. This is an incomplete one. And the other was, we created this event called Talk to Me, which we've done in two more times, actually just recently and at the end of last year, where we set up tables and chairs. This is actually in Calcutta, but I'll just go back here. We set up tables and chairs, and we just invited a complete stranger to come and talk with us for an hour about anything. And Action Heroes were strictly told, you can't talk about street sexual violence. You're not on an agenda. You have to connect, and you have to be at a place where you're willing to connect with someone. And so in that space, were biases broken or not, and the fact that it has to be for an hour, so you can't just keep talking about the weather. I'd like to believe that something shifted in for all of the action heroes that day, and the fact that they were willing to unlearn fear, they were willing to, not in this case, but yeah, they were willing to unlearn fear. And for example, this person on the left described himself as the guy who's outside colleges on the bike and waiting for girls to come out, and this just arrived, you know, this just happened in the conversation. She didn't even ask him about that. And she, so this kind of exchange, or even the biases that they are perceived with in terms of those jeans wearing English speaking girls, to come to a point of where the action leaders were told, this is not an interview, it's a conversation. Can we have a conversation? And can we feel, can we arrive at any place that feels mutually vulnerable, mutually equal in spirit at least? We did it again in Calcutta, where we collaborated with another organization, and this was in Munshiganj area. This was in Delhi at Vasant Vihar. And this is the longer story, but we also did this in a red light area where we had women from the red light area who wanted to participate, and so this is just a start, and it's the first time we ever intervened there, but we're just waiting to see what unfolds. But again, it really takes you through different complexities of understanding the issue of sexual violence and social justice. So at the end, the partners or two action heroes exchanged flowers, and I'm just going to end with this in terms of how we function again, in terms of, again, what the web has enabled. And not just enabled, but the fact that in engagement, we're looking really towards people participating in sharing responsibility of the issue and taking ownership of the issue. So one of the things that happened after the Delhi gang rape, and when there's just been this rise of spotlight on this issue, our immediate concerns were around people are going to blame and then the issue is going to die out, and how do we really mobilize this towards taking ownership of the issue instead of moving in circles. So we started the Safe City Pledge, which is really about seeing the city in a 360 degree way, where each and every one of us belonging to different communities or roles has the ability and potential to influence change, to contribute to a safe city, whether it's you as a parent, whether it's you as as a brother, whether it's you as a policeman, whether it's you as a gynecologist. So on the 1st of January 2013, people in 11 cities, I'm just going to go quickly over to this, people in 11 cities mobilized more people in their cities to step forward and take a very personal pledge. I just wanted to get to these. For example, this is a biology teacher who says, I pledge to teach my students that gender is a social construct and not just biological. Or what would a journalist's safe city pledge look like? Or this is a parent who just coming from a very, very personal space and knowing that there's a small step to a big change, and to be able to, this is a brother who says, I'll encourage my sister to come up and talk more openly. And we share these photographs online, but we don't treat this as a campaign as much as a project where we're looking at, and especially through this year again, to look at different communities of engagement, to make every community realize that they can influence change. This is my most favorite pledge, because only a taxi driver could have taken this pledge. And to really, he says that if a woman enters my taxi after 9 o'clock, I'm going to make sure the doors are locked and I won't stop midway because that might intimidate her. So for each person to come from their own area of expertise and to be able to make change there. Or a gynecologist, and we found him on Twitter actually, because we said, is there a gynecologist around? And he said, the first two were his pledges, the third one was the one where we wanted a gynecologist to pledge to remove moral judgments from the patient's decision over her body. And he took that. So I'll end here. Thank you so much.